of Entertainment presents... Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight from the beautiful Beverly Wilshire Hotel in Hollywood, make that Beverly Hills, ABC is proud to present the following program honoring Howard Cosell. Here this evening are some of the greats from the world of sports, some giants in the world of show business, and some other people who are okay too, I guess. These celebrities have come from all over the country to be here tonight, and for one reason, and one reason only, they're all getting big money for it. In addition, these fabulous celebrities have one common goal. They want to heap praise and a lot of other things on Howard Cosell. This is your announcer, the lovely and talented Ted Knight speaking, and now, a salute to Humble Howard!
Gentlemen, the only pro football player to be voted 11 consecutive times to the All-Pro Bowl game, Merlin Olsen.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome to all of you. I can't help but say that I'm tremendously impressed with the great warmth that permeates this atmosphere tonight. Howard gave me that word, by the way. I think that that's also a tribute to the beautiful people that are associated with the MS Society. We thank you for being here, and now I take great pleasure in introducing our MC for the evening. He's young, he's bright, he's witty, intelligent, and he's Jewish. David Steinberg.
This event could go almost any way tonight. What I would like to establish, at least for the tone of the evening, is not the regular show business atmosphere that we're used to at these sorts of events. We are here to pay tribute to Howard Cosell, an intelligent, literate man of great integrity, and the reason that most of the distinguished members of the dais are here tonight is largely because we all know him personally and respect him. But those are all cliches, and I think at the start, what I would like to reveal is a side of Howard that you can only know if you know him personally. Howard is a racist. I was talking to Howard, you know what? We had a lunch that was very exciting at Bernstein's, right?
PJ's.
PJ Bernstein's in New York. And I said to Howard, what I love about this land is you have the black, and the Jew, and the Puerto Rican, and the Ukrainian. Everyone helps each other as much as they possibly can. And Howard looked at me and said, not a chance. He said in that kind of sensitive way of his, that group is not together unless the black is pushing dope that the Jew needs, that he will sell to the Puerto Rican, who will dilute it and pass it on to the Polak, who will sniff Oxidol. You know, you see Howard Cosell on Time, the cover of Time, the cover of Newsweek. You think that occurs overnight. It wasn't so. A lot of us remember the old days when he used to broadcast the roller derby for Radio Free Europe. There are many reasons to respect Howard Cosell, and I think we must start with a note of seriousness. And I don't even know where to start to establish how much I do respect him. I think the reason I personally do is because he's one of the only men that Xavier Cugat will allow to be alone with Charo. I'm not implying that Howard is a male chauvinist pig. Exactly the opposite. He's blatantly effeminate. But I could go on like this all night. And look who we have here. Look at the upcoming speakers. Muhammad Ali. Muhammad knows I've always been a fan of yours. You know that, Muhammad. I interviewed you many times. And I lost a lot of money on your last fight, Muhammad. But I'm still a fan. As a matter of fact, I feel a debt is a debt. When you've made a bet, you should pay off. So, here's the 10, Howard. Don Meredith is known in almost every field and respected as sportscaster and great football player, great friend of Howard's. When I said to Don, we're paying tribute to Howard Cosell. I know how busy you are. Can you be there? He said instantly, yes, I will be there. And he only made one small request, that we release his family unharmed. And so here he is, Dandy Don Meredith.
Thank you. David, is there any way we can get these mics up a little bit? Huh? Well, it's all right. I'm sorry, David. It's all right. Good. Someone wrote a lot of really neat things for me, and I'm not going to use any of them, because I can't read them. But one of them, and I'll read you the first one, give you a clue. It says that the reason Howard sounds like a monster, if you want to get right down to it, is that he looks like a vampire. Now, he doesn't look like a vampire. He is a vampire. That's what it is. To roast Howard is really, we don't have enough time. And 4 years now we're going into this, and we've eaten in a lot of restaurants around the country. We've traveled a lot together. I don't know whether it has anything to do with his background, his mother, his father. I'm sure he's never picked up a check yet. I think that's good. I really, anybody can do that well that long. I mean, you've got to believe it. A lot of people say what a great memory he has. He never forgets a friend. Big deal. He's only got two. Yeah. I really do owe an awful lot to Howard. He found me as a rejected, semi-beaten-up, run-down Methodist. In just a short period of time, he's turned me into, I've married a Jew. I like bagels. And I don't pick up any checks either. He's been called arrogant, pompous, rude, egotistical, condescending.
It's all true.
Well, I look at it this way. I figure a wife ought to know. You know what I'm talking about? So I never really knew how to pronounce our city of brotherly love until Howard a few years ago told me that it was Philadelphia.
Wasn't that a biggie?
What a
night.
Oh, yeah.
Don Adams, truthfully, one of the most brilliant men ever to walk off a television tube into your living room, as far as I'm concerned, creative. His timing, his delivery has been described as somewhat similar to that of William Lundigan. Don... And I'm glad about this, and you'll understand why, Dandy Don. Don Adams has one quality that William Lundigan will never have. Shortness. Ladies and gentlemen, our brilliant talent, Don Adams.
Hey,
Expected it from Rickles, but not from that little guy.
Well, I can't tell you what a thrill it is.
It may interest you to know that the Sports Writers of America have unanimously voted to have Howard Cosell's tongue bronzed while he is still alive. That idiot laughs at anything I say. Now, Howard Cosell is a strange man with many, many strange habits. First of all, he is known as a loner. However, that isn't by choice. Among his other idiosyncrasies, he is also said to have strange eating habits, which I found to be true tonight when I watched him at dinner eating soup with his fingers. But there's another side of Howard, which not many people know about, and that is the humanitarian side. For example, not many people here tonight know that Howard Cosell, the sportscaster, recently set medical history. He is the only living brain donor. In conclusion, Howard, just let me say that in spite of everything, I've come to think of you as a member of my family. Let me also say that I don't like my family.
You got guts.
I leave you with one thought. It is said that a man can be judged by his friends, which means that there is no way to judge Howard Cosell. Thank you. Yay.
Our next speaker you don't mess around with. Muhammad Ali has a sort of love-hate relationship with Howard Cosell. When I was a kid, I used to wonder what it would be like to be the toughest person in the entire world. Since Muhammad's last fight, he's probably wondering also. Ladies and gentlemen, sorry, Don. My favorite heavyweight since Benny Leonard, Muhammad Ali.
Better than you were against Norton.
What do you mean? What do you mean I better be good? I'm going to be truthful. I'm not.
If you are, it'll be the first time.
I'm not here to honor Howard Cosell or to talk about how privileged I am to be here. I'm only here because I got 4 free round-trip tickets from New York and my money in advance cash. I'm not going to sit up here and talk about, in front of the world, the trouble you give me, how glad I am to be here. I can't say that because I'm not allowed. But all the people here, I want you to know that I've been knowing Howard Cosell for quite a while. During that time, I've made some mistakes. My last fight was won, and you made some mistakes too. But the unique thing about you is you don't make the same mistakes twice because you make too many new ones. I mean, after all, you can, I don't care how many shows they have for you in Hollywood. I don't care how many Don Rickles show up, Bill Russell show up, or who. I know it was me who made you in this country. I was talking to your wife the other day, asking about the show, and what should I say? She said, at one time, you wanted to be a prize fighter, but you had one big fault. They couldn't find a mouthpiece big enough to fit you. Many people talk about your hair. They say, is Howard Cole Sells hair, is it really a phony? I says, no, but most of it comes from the tail of a pony. I've made you so famous in this country, Howard. I've made you every time I go to college. Howard Cosell, all the kids. What about Howard Cosell? Everywhere I go, and I understand you hear the same thing. Everywhere you go, they ask you about me. You've become so popular from hanging around me until there's a new Howard Cosell doll on the market. And the strangest, the most unique thing about this doll is that you don't have to wind it up and it talks anyway. And I want to say this, and I want to get off course to have more people here. Most people, to make it in show business, to be famous, such as Don Rickles, you need a personality. To be a great athlete like myself, you have to have great potentials, such as Bill Russell, and great talent. And to be people like Steve Allen and a few more here, the young lady, you have to have pretty faces. But you are a living witness that you don't have to have none of that stuff.
You're right on.
Thank you, Muhammad. That was wonderful. How does a man like Howard Cosell come along and rise to the top of the industry? Very simply, the sports world was looking for a man with dignity, intelligence, and wit. And Howard is filling in until that man comes along. Next speaker. Man I truly like. He's been in the business for 40 years, and anyone around knows or knew how sensational he was. Now he has a series that's very, very successful called Sanford and Son. Now the rest of the world knows. Ladies and gentlemen, my two favorite four-letter words, Red Fox.
When I look at Howard Cosell, it makes me glad that black people all look alike. I prayed so hard for Howard to get something, I got it. Strep throat, it's gonna be difficult for me to really say what I have to say, but I'm gonna try hard because I like Howard Cosell. He's a man of convictions, and both of them were for drunk driving. Some people say you are what you eat. If that's the case, Howard must be eating garbage. And some scientists at UCLA played a tape of Howard Cosell's voice to a rat to see what would happen. After 15 minutes, the rat had built himself an electric chair, sat down in it, and pulled a switch. Something else. Howard Cosell had a lot of trouble when he was in Japan. Every time when someone said, "Aso," he would turn around and say, "Are you talking to me?" Also, the Hollywood... The Hollywood Wax Museum has a statue of Howard Cosell. They wanted it to be completely authentic, so they made it out of fertilizer.
Give me them jokes.
And Howard uses a lot of big words, and so does Shirley Chisholm. And I've noticed something about people that use big words, they're usually ugly. I like that joke. It shows my power of elocution. And a lot of you don't know this, why black people like Howard Cosell, because we enjoy watching a white guy making a fool out of himself. In closing, I'd like to say this. I think Howard ought to quit TV work and get a job more suited for him. He ought to be a bicycle seat.
Thank you, Red. We'll try and use some of that. Since Howard Cosell is a living legend, what we thought we would do is talk to the average man in the street and find out what they thought of Howard Cosell. And we interviewed hundreds, and here's the 30 seconds of footage that we could use. There seemed to be a certain sameness about the attitude towards Howard. We'd like to show you just a short bit of footage of interviews with the man in the street as to what they thought of Howard Cosell.
I don't think anything of Howard Cosell.
He's an individual, and what we need in America is more individuals.
He's a pain in the neck.
Sometimes you can just knock him on the head.
He's mean and he's funny, and I like that.
He got a round mouth, big mouth, and his tongue is slower than a turtle, but he's a good caster.
Howard Cosell is a sportscaster. Haven't you heard of him?
No. Well, we're not from this country. We come from a civilized place called England.
He's not only a sportscaster, he's an entertainer.
He's a pretty good actor.
He's done a lot for sports announcing, more broadcasting.
Because I enjoy his broadcasting.
He seems to be one of the few really intelligent guys doing sportscasting.
Would you people let me through? This is American television. Let me through. We're getting through now. Here we are. Sir, you've been shot. When did you know it was all over?
Fascist dictators.
Well, of course, you're upset, and that's understandable under the circumstances. I guess now you'll have to announce your retirement. Well, good luck to you, sir. Good luck to you.
What commentator? Oh, no. It can't be possible. Do you watch Monday Night Football?
Yeah, but I turn the sound off.
What would you do if you were alone on a deserted island with Howard Cosell?
I'd learn to swim.
I think I prefer to watch football on TV. He's one of the reasons.
He tells it as it is. He's a nice man. God keep him. God bless him. And he make a very good job.
Our next speaker, the eminent psychologist, Dr. Joyce Brothers. What better personality to deal with Howard Cosell than a psychologist who deals with neurotics on a daily basis? So without further ado, the only living psychologist in America without any credentials, Dr. Joyce Brothers.
Thank you.
Cassell was born in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, on March 25th, 1920. The delivery was particularly difficult because he was born in an unusual position. He had his foot in his mouth. Even as a baby, Howard had a profound effect upon people. As a matter of fact, it was his baby picture that started the movement for Planned Parenthood. Howard Cosell was a chronic bedwetter. But I'm really getting ahead of myself. We'll talk about his adult life later. At the age of 9, Howard got his first taste of sports when a kid in the neighborhood hit a line drive down his throat. Howard wasn't very popular at school. As a matter of fact, he wasn't very popular anywhere. At the age of 12, he was punched in the nose by Dale Carnegie. On his 13th birthday, Howard won first place in the Maria Ospenskaya look-alike contest. In 1941, the war broke out, and so did Howard's face. At the age of 18, Howard had his first date, an older woman named Laverne Latour. At the time she was dating Howard, Laverne was also dating someone else, the Navy. His affair with Laverne only lasted a few months, and then her sight returned. It was then that Howard vowed to live a life of celibacy, a vow which his wife tells us he has not yet broken. Today, Howard Cosell is the most well-known sports commentator on ABC. He could have been on NBC or CBS, but ABC lost the bet. In the past few minutes, I've made fun of Howard's life. But after all is said and done, Howard Cosell is really a great man. As Dr. Kinsey said, he's all right in my book.
Thank you, Dr. Brothers. Now, ladies and gentlemen, a very special surprise. To present the Sportscaster of the Year award to Howard Cosell, the Newscaster of the Year, Mr. Ted Knight.
Hi, guys. It's a pleasure to be here tonight to honor my closest and dearest friend, Harold Cosell. To be chosen Sportscaster of the Year is a great honor. Not as great as being chosen Newscaster of the Year, but we all can't be captains. Some of us have to be the crew, Harold. I just want you to know that I admire you, Harold. I admire specifically the way you announced that thrilling fight between Joe Frazier and Muhammad Jabbar here. No, Harold. You and I have a lot in common. I don't remember what it is, but I, for the life of me, I know we do. Prut, right, Harold? Of course, I'm not a stranger to sportscasting, as you can well see. I might add with a little more style than you do. And I look better, too, Harold, when you come to think of it. See this nose? $500. I made all the payments, too. I hope they paid for the suit, but you wouldn't understand that, would you, Harold? Come to think of it, Harold, You know what you are? You're a phony.
This guy's a substitute.
I have too much integrity to give this fine award to you, you blowhard. This award should go to someone who really deserves it. It should go to me, and I humbly accept it. Thank you.
It has come time. Throughout recorded time. It's a difficult introduction. There have always been men who satirized society, men who weren't afraid to poke fun at those in high esteem. Great men like Mark Twain and Will Rogers. Don Rickles has nothing in common with them. I know Don, and I like him a lot, as do a lot of us here on the panel, and we know that what he does is not done for money, and it's not done for fame. It's done out of a deep-rooted hatred for mankind. Ladies and gentlemen, again, a brilliant comedian, Mr. Don Rickles.
Where are your notes?
Yeah. Thank you, David. I would just like to say, first of all, to the gentleman and the lady of the dais, David, I want to thank you for chipping in and getting a buck and a half sports shirt and making a whole outfit out of it. I've never seen a Jewish clown up close. Sir. I want to thank the wonderful black folks on the dais. All you guys here having a good time, and the train of Baltimore has nobody to serve lunch. See if Muhammad's laughing. If Muhammad ain't laughing, go into glory, glory, hallelujah. I kid about people. That is my reputation. That is why I'm here tonight, because we're entertaining a big joke. Oh, my time out, Cleveland. Muhammad, I heard your speech, and I say publicly and honestly, you were a great champion. You've had some great fights. The Joe Frazier fight, the Kenny Norton fight, you and I know you took a dive. Angelo Dundee, his trainer, went, lay down, your mother, lay down. Don Meredith, who is dumber than Muhammad, is explaining it. Don Meredith is making friends with Muhammad Ali, and he lives in the heart of Texas going, let's get him, y'all. Let's get Muhammad and have a cookout. I kid you. Black or white, it doesn't matter to me. We're all human beings.
Why do you keep talking about it, dude?
I want to thank you, Muhammad, for butting in while I was talking. I hope your hair gets kinky again. Attaboy, Howard. Show your class. Smell the table. I say from the bottom of my heart, I've known you quite a few years. I've watched you bring the Monday night football games. In fact, the wife and I, when we fool around, we watch you. I'll put it another way, Howard. You're a dull guy. I do want to say, though, Roosevelt Greer, one of the great champions here, Don and you. Roosevelt Greer played with the New York Giants, I believe, in 1906. And they didn't wear helmets. They just ran into the wall and went, eh. That's why they say some of the black people are slow. That's only a joke, Muhammad. Muhammad, mifine machane machane, which means I hope your snake dies.
Is this too fast for you, Father? We have a priest in the audience going, where are we, Alice? And he's married. Anyway, I assume you're a reverend. Is that correct, sir? Good. Just nod your head if you hear anything. Getting back to you, Howard, and that is difficult. There is a new thing out, Howard, which you probably haven't heard about. It's called cologne. I've been sitting next to you for about an hour now, and for about half of it, I thought it was me. There's a new thing out called soap and a hot tub, Howard. You're going to go mildew, Howard, if you don't wash up pretty soon. See that tooth, the glue hardens and makes your brain go soft. And you are Jewish, because with that nose, if you ain't, you're a falcon on the loose, I'll tell you. This is why this man has to be put in a home. Put him in a home before he hurts your child. This is a weirdo, folks. He's the kind of guy that hangs around the alley going, psst, fella. But I kid you, and why do I kid you? Because you're dumb and annoying. You're a Jewish man, and I'm a Jewish man, and I say from my heart...
Don't tell me your troubles.
I don't tell you my troubles. I quote the words of a great rabbi, Rabbi Eli Alekiva, who said, let the life of thyself, Howard, bring thy life to thee. Vith thy fay, thy felt. This jerk understands it.
Sitting here like a yo-yo going, yeah, that's true.
Later on, David, you're going to do your wonderful Hanukkah poem.
Roosevelt Greer went, what is that, Hanukkah? Is that some sort of festival their mothers have?
But to all of you folks in the room, at the end of this evening, this entire room will be sprayed. Howard does give off some sort of rare fungus. He's the only guy that goes to a health club and people say, put the towel on.
You like that, huh, Bill?
He's got that kind of body. I've seen you in the nude, Howard, and I say this from my heart. Become a girl.
The reverend just went, is that funny, Alice?
Anyway...
I'm kind of tired.
I wasn't here for the money I'm getting, folks. I'm a hit. No, I was outside helping the wonderful Chinese kid going, you got a car? I said, yeah, and he parked it, and I came in kill an hour here. But good luck to you, Howard, from the bottom of my heart and to all of you. Remember, love sports, love the game. The late, great Newt Rockne said, if you hit him hard, you hit him soft. Hit him hard and hard and soft. To you, Howard, really, I wish you what I have. A little gas right over here. About 5 o'clock in the morning, just when you and Em are going to make a move. As you're laying in bed, and Em goes, Howard, and you go... So on behalf of my family, I wish you what I have. All the good things in life, and may you be blessed with following and fans as you have in the past and in the present. You are indeed a gentleman and a guy with class, because a turnout like this does not come just for people to kill an evening. It comes from a man who's important. Thank you for making me feel a little important by being one of your guests this evening. Bless you and good luck.
Our next guest, a great man and tall man. Every kid wants to grow up to be a sportscaster of his stature. Every kid wants to grow up to be a basketball player of his stature. I think pretty much every kid wants to grow up to be Mr. Bill Russell.
Hello, Howard.
Still have trouble being understood, don't you, Bill?
Right. I would like
very much to say that it's a real pleasure to be here. But I wouldn't lie to you. You know, Howard, Howard Cosell is a type of man that would make Golda Meir anti-Semitic. And you know, it's really weird. I see all these football players and football coaches around here. And, well, you've seen all the players and things. I'm going to slow down a little bit. I don't want to offend the football players. But what I can't figure out is what they're doing here. And Howard can't even walk and chew gum at the same time. And, you know, Howard, supposed to tell it like it is.
What and, do you mean,
you know,
suppose?
And, like I said, suppose. And some people say, well, he must offend the minorities. Well, actually, the only minority that Howard offends are the intelligent people. But he's cool. He's really cool. In fact, the last time I saw anyone as cool as Howard, he'd been dead for about a week. But Howard, I tell you the truth. In saying some of these mean and nasty things about you, it makes me feel so good. But you know, Howard, one of these days you're going to have to go on and you're going to have to retire. And it's going to be tough to fill your shoes. It'll take 3 or 4 shovelfuls. And you know, I was in New York City and was going to ABC, and I went to the revolving door, and Howard went out. So naturally I had to go back out, because Mohammed always goes to the mountain. And Howard Cosell said to me, "Bill Russell, how does it feel to stand here in the face of greatness?" So, Howard, just in case there's any doubt about it, you ain't nothing, you never was nothing, and you never will be nothing. But I like you anyway.
My fascination with show business began about the time I first heard the name Steve Allen. Steve Allen, the man who made the Tonight Show what it is today, the Johnny Carson Show. Steve Allen, the man who discovered so many talented people, a man so versatile, composer and a writer. I couldn't imagine how one man could do so many things. It wasn't until years later that I found out his formula. Hard work, long hours, and a total disregard for quality. Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Allen.
Thank you very much, David. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm so tired of laughing that I don't do... Well, who cares what I'm tired of? I've been making some notes throughout the evening, and unfortunately, now that I stand up here, I realize I can't read them. Because, well, I'm not as tall as Bill Russell. I'm 6'3", and they got this thing down here a lot lower than I'd like to have it. If I had an eye in my navel, I'd be... very funny for the next few minutes, but it's going to be kind of an adventure for both of us. I suppose most of you folks are aware of the fact that there's been a writer's strike going on for the past couple of months here in Hollywood, and I think it shows tonight. But I mean, it was an unusual thrill to hear Joyce Brothers do a lot of jokes written for Henny Youngman. We are gathered here, of course, to pay tribute to the David Suss kind of sports.
I resent that.
Well, to hell with you. Now, as you've just seen evidence, Howard is a man who's not afraid to say what he thinks, whether he's actually thinking or not. It doesn't matter to him. Personally, I'm very proud to be able to present to you, Howard, this evening, the Don Rickles Award for Distinguished Rudeness. I think you really, really have it coming. And a little later in the evening, as we think it'll be the high point of the proceedings, John Cameron Swayze is going to strap a Timex on Howard's tongue. It'll take a licking, but it'll keep on ticking. We make a lot of jokes about Howard Cassell. Not all of them sensational, now that I think of it. But actually, he is well known in the world of sports for his sensitive awareness of talent at an early stage of its development. He's not always correct in his judgments, of course. He is the man, after all, who told Mark Spitz that he would never make it. And he told him that last week. Nevertheless, it is with a great feeling of heartburn, ladies and gentlemen, that I stand before you at this late hour of the night to extend quite sincerely my warm good wishes. All of us, I guess, here at the dais have sat in your chair, Howard, and we know that the cracks at one's expense are fun. But it does help every few minutes to alleviate the pain a little bit if we tell you we're very happy to be with you, and we wish you all of our love and good wishes. Good wishes. Thank you.
Oral Roberts is not with us tonight, but Slappy White is. What they have in common is simply the silliest first names in show business. Slappy White has spent his years perfecting his craft. He's one of the great storytellers. In his style of comedy, he's known as one of the best. Ladies and gentlemen, Slappy White.
Thank you, Howard. Oh, this is how. Thank you, Howard. Don't get mad. I don't know you. I'd like to thank Howard Cosell for getting my friends that table in the parking lot tonight. And I know that anytime a show has been on this long, and you've got a lot of giant stars on the podium to follow in such a fall down in this routine, what they wrote for me is not going to go. So I am going into my act. And I'm glad to see a lot of my folks here tonight. You know the new rule, 10 of us supposed to be everywhere. They told me if I do good here tonight that I will have my own black show on ABC. Because if they put another black show on NBC, that peacock will be a crow. So I like to do good here tonight. And if you notice, there's a lot of black shows on television. Bill Cosby was the first black to make it big when he got on I Spy. Then he got his own show where he played an athletic coach. You see, he won the Lester Maddox Scholarship Award at Ole Miss. He was a javelin catcher. Flip Wilson put on a dress. He got a television show for 3 years. I put on a dress. The judge gave me 6 months. We got an old black show coming out next week called Harlem on the Prairie. Starring Roosevelt Greer. Now, we all know Roosevelt Greer can't act, but who gonna tell him? But seriously, I do know Howard Cosell because he asked me to fly out here to do this show tonight. And I don't like to fly because I'm nervous on plane. It was the first time I was ever on a plane where you had to chip in to buy gas. And the restroom was outside. We're flying along and the plane hits the air pocket, dropped about 200 feet, said shoo. And some guy sitting next to me said, "Hey, Whitey." I am sort of a hard luck comedian. I like to have my own show. I would like to have my own show. Friends, let me go over tonight.
Yeah, that's right.
So I can have my own show. I didn't come here to help Howard Cosell. I came here to help myself. I'm glad that I did get a smile or two out of you ladies and gentlemen tonight. Thanks for using my own judgment and not using what the writers gave me. And Howard, there's nothing I can say about you, seriously, because I've never met you before, Howard. I thought you were Howard. And he did give me one piece of advice that I hope they don't cut out. He said, "Slappy, when you're out there in California, it's new to you out there, and they have the freeways. And when you're driving in California, the best time to drive on the freeways is 9:30 on Sunday morning. Because that time of morning, the Catholics are in church, the Jews are in Palm Springs, the blacks are in jail, and the Mexicans can't get their cars started." So, meeting you for the first time, I'd like to say, Howard, it was a pleasure.
Seated at this table are great comedians, great athletes, and great human beings. Our next speaker, Alex Karras, definitely falls into one of these three categories. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Alex Karras.
I've happened to know Howard for quite a while, a long, long time, and I don't like him. I can't speak for all the athletes around the country. I don't know everyone, but those people that I do know detest him terribly. Of course, I don't blame Howard Cosell at all. I blame the guy that hired him, Rune Arledge. Can you imagine the demented personality he must have? Tonight.
We've done a lot of insulting here tonight, and we've saved the final insult for the end.
Hurry up, will you, Dave?
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Howard Cosell.
Sit down, he's going to talk.
Oh, okay.
Let this cry, Howard.
This won't take long.
Well, I've got to say this to you, Rickles. You've all been throwing spitballs at a battleship. He's friendly with Muhammad Ali, and I evaluate him the way I as a performer, the way I evaluate a fighter. Don Rickles is the greatest lightweight I have ever seen. Alex Karras smiles down there. Let me tell you about that man. He established beyond peradventure that fat, out-of-condition athletes could excel in the National Football League. Don, for the life of me, I don't understand why you're out of work and why none of the three networks want you, but I've got a recommendation for you. Instantly, I want you to write NBC and apply for a guest spot on Monday Night Baseball. That's your bag, baby. Steve Allen, I've just finished my new book. It'll be published in October.
And then he's going to read another one, folks.
It's... There is Bill Russell. Go Up for Glory was the name of his book, but Bill never did. As for Meredith, you know all about him. No man ever lost more games under crisis conditions than Meredith. It's always nice to see my friend Muhammad Ali. There's already been talk here tonight of his extraordinary performance against... Probably the greatest heavyweight I've ever seen, Ken Norton. It's a very nice thing for me to be this geographically proximate to David Steinberg. I'm absolutely certain that when you find the right business, you'll succeed. Red Fox. We have never before, until this occasion, had Red Fox and Slappy White on ABC. And our network is not about to allow it again. And Joyce Brothers came to us at a most fortuitous moment in the wake of Margaret Court's crushing defeat at the hands of Bobby Riggs. And as for Merlin Olsen, big number 74... It's a nice thing to see a man get up here joyously, participate in a cause like this, and know that he can accept with good grace the fact that his playing days are over. On the serious side...
You've covered that, Howard.
Who resuscitated him? I disposed of him.
I'm sorry, folks. I started to enjoy myself.
It's been a great evening for me. I've languished in Rickles failures through the years. Couldn't beat those little Catholic kids when they attacked you going to school, could you, huh?
They had the uniforms.
I've enjoyed the evening very much. I really have. I like to see people with lesser talent try and get at a great one. I think it's normal. And I knew in the ultimate, the failure would be theirs, as has been proved tonight. But most seriously, I think of a line... As we close the evening by a very great poet, John Keats, his first line in his sonnet on first looking into Chapman's Homer, which reads, "Much have I traveled in the realms of gold, And in my lifetime, I really have. And for me tonight was a nugget because of the cause involved and because of these very, very outstanding people who've been nice enough to come here tonight to roast me. And as I talk about nuggets, all the gold in my life is in occasions like these, of course, but most supremely, and that lovely lady over there who is my bride, and my two daughters, my two grandsons, and my son-in-law. And for all of the realms of gold that I've traveled, I'm ever so grateful to them. Thank you very much.